Please welcome to the stage, Director Analyst, Gartner Research and Advisory, Caroline Chumakoff.
Good morning, and welcome to the 2023 Gartner Supply Chain Symposium. Supply chain has a long history. From the moment humans decided to make things, we organized the first supply chain. From the Great Pyramids of Giza to rocket ships to the moon, we've been sharpening this tool we call supply chain. And generations of leaders like yourselves have dedicated their lives to the building and shipping of things. Like my dad. My dad spent 40 years in supply chain before retiring last year. He's also the biggest supply chain nerd that I know. And I work with supply chain nerds every day. So how do I know he was the most epic supply chain nerd of all time? Our family dinner table conversations were about supply chain. Sound familiar? He'd go on and on about new technologies. He'd sketch out packaging solutions. And on road trips, we'd curiously find ourselves on pit stops to manufacturing sites. So after his retirement, I had to ask him, "Dad, what comes to your mind when you think about your legacy?" His answer completely surprised me. He said that his life objective was to ensure the prosperity of future generations of Chumakoffs. He wanted to marry a great woman, find financial stability, and teach his children to be caring, studious, adventurous, and creative. He wasn't going on about any professional accomplishment of his own, but equating his legacy to future generations. It got me thinking about what we are going to leave behind for future generations of supply chain leaders and employees. What will be our legacy? Will we leave a supply chain profession that lights up brilliant careers, feed global economies, and sustain our planet? Make supply chain mission critical to the success of every enterprise, a trusted partner in the C-suite? We may do these things, but there is no doubt that we're facing challenges. Employee turnover in supply chain is 33% higher than pre-pandemic. Only a quarter of our employees are highly engaged, and only 16% of them are willing to go above and beyond in their jobs. Our employees are checked out, challenged, and choosing to quiet quit, which is a problem because we kind of need them. Labor productivity is at its lowest point in decades. Take a moment to let that set in. The productivity we gain from our people is at its lowest in decades. The human story is one of progress, and yet now our productivity has stalled, which poses a vital question in the face of an aspirational legacy. Have we already reached peak human productivity? The data says that we have, but there are gaps in the story that suggest otherwise. Over 100 years, the technology productivity story takes us from widespread adoption of the telephone, to adoption of the internet, to cloud computing, to machine learning and AI. The supply chain productivity story takes us from developing warehouse pallets, to standardized containers, to the third industrial revolution, to globalization of supply chain. Decades of boundless progress. But there's a massive gap in the story of people productivity. With the shift to the 40-hour work week, the 1920s saw the last major people productivity breakthrough. Until a global pandemic forced us to do something different? Where would we be if technology progress had stopped in the 1920s? The transistor, a key component of all semiconductors, would have never been invented. You think there's a semiconductor shortage now? They literally wouldn't exist. So imagine what productivity we could gain if we invested equally in our people. If we choose to learn from history rather than repeat it, we can reach new peaks. We can achieve breakthrough productivity. We can secure our legacy. All of this can be done by unlocking the collective potential of the supply chain. Collective potential is the recognition that the whole of your supply chain is greater than the sum of its parts. Each individual employee you hire, the communities you build inside and outside of the organization, and the technology you implement contribute more together than apart. Let's take a moment to consider what collective potential can look and feel like.
For thousands of years, humans have pushed the boundaries of knowledge, technology, performance. But achieving today's aspirations will require new breakthroughs in productivity. What if? A question that invites us to imagine. What if we could tap into the talents of everyone on our team? What if we could break down silos and work together seamlessly? What if we could reimagine our partnerships with technology? What if all three were possible? We would grow, achieve, improve productivity, individuals, community, technology, a powerful combination to unlock our collective potential.
So today, let's talk about three things that make up our collective potential. Three things waiting to be unlocked. Individuals, communities, technologies. We can unlock individual potential by accessing the capabilities of everyone on our teams. We can unlock community potential by mobilizing people to action. And we can unlock technological potential by redesigning how humans and machines work together. This powerful combination is what will allow us to fully achieve our collective potential. Let's start by talking about individual potential. How can we get the most out of each and every individual in our organizations? Maybe it's a matter of seeing what was already there. I'd like all of you to stand up for me, please, if you're able. Please stay standing if you have a skill that is not fully utilized in your current role. Take a moment to look around you. There are thousands of skills going untapped in this room alone. Imagine what would happen if we asked this question of your teams. Thank you. You can sit down again now. We are in the midst of a supply chain labor shortage. But we are leaving valuable skills on the table. And this happens to even the best of the best in their field. Oprah Winfrey was fired as a reporter because she was unfit for television. J.K. Rowling's pitch for Harry Potter was rejected 12 times because it was too long for kids. Walt Disney was fired from a newspaper for not being creative enough. Walt Disney. This happens when we treat employees like fungible assets, where each of them is a uniform storage cube. We assume we know the contents, and we assume they are replaceable. But each and every one of those storage cubes contains a unique combination of skills and motivations that could be better aligned to work. Instead of designing uniform job descriptions that assume every employee has the same strengths, we have an opportunity to reimagine the roles that people can play within the organization. Let's see how Unilever unlocked what was in each cube. Unilever built what they call their open talent economy, an online talent marketplace where managers can access skills almost on demand. They break down projects into component skills, and they seek those skills from internal and external sources. Employees are invited to apply latent skills and play different roles within the organization. The Belgian-based pharmaceutical company UCB expands on this concept. UCB noticed that their category manager was being asked to be a jack of all trades. In their job description, they were responsible for source to procure, business partnering, negotiation, category strategy creation, supplier management. And on top of all of that, they needed to manage employees. UCB took this exhaustive job description and broke it down into 6 core roles and matched one core role to the unique skills of each employee. By shifting from jobs to roles, they gained greater productivity in each of the core work areas and greater discretionary effort from employees because they were energized by their work. Employees were also invited to choose specialty roles that fit their personal interests. For example, joining a sustainability special interest community or taking on peer development support. Gartner research has shown that going beyond flexibility of when and where employees work and offering radical flexibility, like UCB, allowing employees to choose who they work with, what they work on, and how much they work, can lead to a 40% increase in the percentage of high performers. Imagine the productivity you could gain from your teams if 40% more of them were high performers. Unlocking individual productivity is about individualizing work itself. But the past 3 years have shown us that the line between work and life is very fuzzy. In fact, our employees would prefer it disappear altogether. 82% of employees say it's important for their employer to see them as a person, not just an employee. To see their family, the communities they're a part of, their hobbies. And yet, less than half of employees believe that their organization actually sees them this way. Employees have always wanted this to some degree. In the early 1990s, my mom was a married social worker with a master's degree and a bright future ahead of her. But she and my dad had 2 girls under the age of 3 at home. And this was a time when teleworking wasn't a thing, when flexible work wasn't a thing, when on-site daycare wasn't a thing. And so given that she earned much less than my dad, the burden fell on her to make a tough choice. She left the workforce and took her skills and motivations with her. Luckily, things have changed for the better. We now have all the tools to support our employees and their lives. So it shouldn't be a surprise that they're demanding this. We need to move to a management philosophy that embraces the human. After all, according to Gartner research, 100% of the employees in your organization are, in fact, human. It's true. We verified it. So a human-centered leadership approach makes the most sense, and it delivers the greatest return. Human-centric leaders improve employee intent to stay by 12 percentage points. And they improve employee well-being by 30 percentage points. They improve employee engagement by another 37 engagement points. But a majority of us are not seeing these benefits because human-centric leadership is not all that common. Today, less than a third of business leaders are effective human leaders. If we want people to stay, if we want to improve engagement, if we want to improve employee well-being, then human-centric leadership is the future of leadership. To be a more human leader, there are three critical skills. Leaders should demonstrate authenticity. As leaders, we're here to model and enable true self-expression, to acknowledge the full picture of the employee, and even to acknowledge our own strengths and weaknesses. Like a CSO communicating that they don't have the full picture of what will happen during an acquisition, but that they're doing their best to gather information and support the team through the change. Leaders should also practice empathy. Empathy is showing genuine care, respect, and concern for our employees' well-being. Like taking a moment to ask your direct reports where they're feeling overwhelmed and exploring what can be taken from their plates. And leaders of the future will embody adaptivity. Just as our customers expect to be a segment of one, so do our employees. We need to be able to show that we can meet individual needs. Like a manager recognizing that a majority of their team are young parents with kids, and revising work patterns to accommodate school pickups and soccer games. Procter & Gamble gives us some insight into what this can look like in practice. P&G's Beautiful Minds program redesigned recruitment around an untapped talent pool, neurodiverse candidates. Leaders at P&G demonstrated authenticity by disrupting the interview process. For example, to make neurodiverse candidates more comfortable with the process, they organized day-long workshops using Lego Mindstorm kits to test critical skills. They demonstrated empathy by addressing key challenges of the old recruiting process, removing language from job descriptions that might discourage neurodiverse candidates from applying. And they demonstrated adaptivity by partnering with the Autism Resource Center, training P&G line managers and onboarding buddies. This program provides them critical access to skills like master data maintenance, forecasting, and data and analytics. P&G is designing talent processes around the individual they want to recruit, not retrofitting the individual to an old process. Unlocking individual potential challenges us to design around the individual, shifting from generic job descriptions, aligning roles to skills, doubling down on human-centric leadership with authenticity, empathy, and adaptivity. This is about inspiring people to unlock their individual potential. But none of us work alone. So we need to talk about how we can work more effectively together. Let's talk about building communities. Think about the communities you're a part of. Your running club, your fan club of a sports team, your fellow lovers of jazz music, your children's school, your volunteer network. Why do you participate in these communities? You opt in because you share an interest and a purpose with these people. You feel a sense of belonging, and you work toward collective goals. We've been learning to build community our whole lives, beginning in school, where you might have participated in sports, music, drama, or robotics. Yes, robotics. Some of you might be familiar with FIRST, FIRST is a global community whose mission is to inspire young individuals of all ages to be technology innovators. At the high school level, with only the support of adult mentors, individuals participate in the FIRST Robotics Challenge. Students self-organize and have 45 days to design a robot. Then comes the Robotics Challenge competitions, or as they prefer to call it, a co-operatition. Before each round of co-operatition, one group is teamed up with two other schools. They learn what each other's robot can do best, and then strategize how to cooperate to score more points or play defense. For every round, they're paired with new teams and have to build new alliances to maximize the potential of all three teams. FIRST is teaching students how to strategize, collaborate, and cooperate. And this act of coming together is natural for us as human beings. When challenges arise, we come together as a community. But we've taken this natural affinity to collaborate, and we've engineered it out with the hierarchy, where dreaded silos emerge, and dividing groups into functions or departments starts to create an us versus them feeling, where information has to be fed from layer to layer. How many of you have been on an email chain escalation that takes you 30 minutes to unravel? Likewise, it's a recurring nightmare of mine. What in the past felt like hierarchy now feels like bureaucracy. In fact, our research shows that the more layers of management we add, the harder it is for our employees to do their jobs. The hierarchy, whether we centralize or decentralize, presents real limitations to employee agility and resilience. The Consumer Products Organization Hire recognized these limitations. Instead, they envisioned an organization where every employee has direct accountability to customers. They did this by breaking down legacy functions into autonomous teams called microenterprises, or MEs. MEs are set up like mini businesses, each with their own profit and loss management. These microenterprises are cross-functional teams of 10 to 15 people that self-organize to achieve their mission. Type 1 MEs sense customer needs. Type 2 MEs respond to those needs. By disrupting the hierarchy, Hire was able to reduce delivery cycles by 15 days, reduce procurement costs by 7%, and grow revenue fivefold in just 2 years. Now, Hire is an advanced case of restructuring to disrupt the hierarchy, but there are other ways that we can rise past this challenge. In fact, we might not need to significantly change the structure at all. Let's go to Ken Chadwick, a VP analyst at Gartner on the forefront of our organization design research, for his insights into how we can break past the hierarchy for greater productivity.
How can we imagine what lies beyond hierarchy? Well, we've done it before. Transport yourself back to March of 2020, the earliest days of the pandemic. Uncertainty was at its peak, with fear for employee safety, supplier challenges, customer demands, patient demands, new employee needs. In an instant, we had to pivot, find creative solutions, make decisions quickly, take on more risk. How many companies reorganized in March of 2020 to meet this challenge? None. There was no time. Instead, people simply started working together differently. New teams were born, teams that worked across reporting lines. The high risk of moving slowly forced us to do what was necessary to make decisions quickly, to stop playing by the rules of the hierarchy. we chose to suspend the illusion. We chose to shift decisions to those best suited to make them. We chose to make decisions with the information we had. We chose to make trade-offs in our decisions. We chose to work together. We chose to trust each other. We chose pursuit of a common objective. That is the power of community. And that is how supply chain leaders can overcome organizational silos today.
In the face of disruption and ambiguity, no organization structure will be perfect. Our response to COVID proves that we can solve problems within the structures we have today. We can mobilize people to action by building communities, targeted at specific challenges and aligned on key objectives. And there are micro and macro communities we can build. As a quick response to disruption, we might organize a small tiger team. Where we want greater agility in everyday issues, we might implement agile teams or self-directed work teams. When we need greater governance in high-risk situations, we might introduce steering committees. Change management can be outsourced to the masses with change networks and communities of practice. And disrupting ourselves through innovation can take the form of crowdsourcing communities. But the most macro community of all? Ecosystems. Ecosystems are macro communities that allow us to mobilize beyond the enterprise. Let's look at Becton Dickinson, a medical devices manufacturer who used tiger teams to respond to inflationary pressures. Led by procurement, they created what they called the Inflation Nerve Center. They brought together procurement, operations, R&D, commercial, and manufacturing teams. And everyone was eager to support the cause. They used technical levers, like changing product specifications and product redesign, to remove components with heavy inflationary pressure. And they used commercial levers, like adjusting contracts and minimum order quantities, to make sure that they weren't pushing the impact of inflation down onto their suppliers. They were able to achieve remarkable success, all without impacting the product or customer experience. As their CPO, Kevin Nelson, put it, we were taking the moment we were having in procurement and turned it into a movement. BD's is a great example of how we can mobilize beyond reporting lines. But these groups need to be able to achieve business outcomes while also avoiding incidents like cybersecurity risks. This requires us to shift our decision-making approach from command and control to connected, contextual, and continuous. What we call the three C's of decision-making. Decision-making must be connected to key stakeholders. Each decision should include input from peers, attempt to deliver consensus across necessary stakeholders, and be backed by a clear rationale. Good decision-making also requires the context of the extended supply chain, where we're leveraging data from customers, suppliers, and public sources, and reflecting on the impact of our decisions on the end-to-end supply chain and its partners. And decision-making should be continuous. We constantly evaluate the factors going into decision-making because they're likely to change. We focus on closing the gap between making a decision and executing on it. And we accelerate decision-making automation. To see the three C's in action, let's look to Land O'Lakes, a US-based agricultural cooperative. Land O'Lakes' digital ecosystem, co-founded with Microsoft, includes many partners from the dairy industry, trucking companies, beverage firms, tech firms, and even competitors. There's complexity with so many partners, but the three C's optimize the ecosystem. Decision-making is connected. Farmers, retailers, and ag tech companies make decisions that meet each partner's goals. Decision-making is contextual. Each party uses data to assess the impact of a decision on ecosystem partners. And decision-making is continuous because the ecosystem leverages decision automation. For example, farmers get tailored planting and harvesting plans auto-executed through smart products. Land O'Lakes illustrates that connected communities require a dynamic decision-making approach. To fully unlock community potential, we should challenge ourselves to mobilize people beyond the hierarchy. You can do this tomorrow. Pinpoint a core opportunity, evaluate its scope and scale, and organize a community-driven response. Encourage communities to make decisions more continuously within the context of the extended supply chain and in connection to stakeholder priorities. Empowered communities allow us to work together. But how can they work at the speed of business? This is where technology comes in. Remember all that technology progress I mentioned at the beginning? It hasn't come without its anxieties. In fact, many of you will likely remember a not-so-distant technology doomsday, the infamous Y2K bug. At the end of 1999, with the millennium approaching, programmers were scrambling to fix the flaw. We had all kinds of fears. Computers would stop working, financial markets would crash, power plants would blow up, planes would fall from the sky. People were literally building bunkers to prepare for the apocalypse. And then, nothing. What we were afraid of most didn't happen. But we see similar stories being told over and over again. The new Y2K bug is here. Self-driving trucks are crashing on the highways. Algorithms open us up to new regulatory risk. And most fearful of all, ChatGPT is coming for our jobs. AI and machine learning advances like ChatGPT raise red flags for our employees. We tell them to adopt machine-driven demand forecasting, but their job is on the line. They don't trust the AI. So they go in to make changes, and the machine says to them, "I'm sorry, Dave. I'm afraid I can't change that forecast." The HAL 9000, the Terminator, the Matrix, Westworld, all send shivers down our spines. Why? Because technology has gone rogue and is taking over. This is what scares us. And it highlights a dysfunctional relationship between employees and technology. It also explains why we might not be seeing the payoff that we expect from all of our technology investments. In fact, 67% of CFOs say that digital is underperforming against expected outcomes. Turning this number around is imperative, because the number one strategic business priority for boards of directors for the next 2 years is digital tech initiatives. So what if instead of a dystopian horror movie, we rewrote the script to be a superhero movie? Think Iron Man and his digital assistant Jarvis. Think Black Panther and her nanotechnology suit. Think Batman and his cave of gadgets. Technology has the potential to be a benevolent partner to our employees. But to turn this into a superhero story, we need a new framework to redefine the human-technology relationship. Start with your appetite for change. Is incremental change enough? Or do you need full-scale transformation? And second, think about where your workforce gives you a competitive advantage. Where is your workforce a tool and interchangeable with technology? And where are they a cornerstone with capabilities that aren't easily replicated? Leading organizations are already experimenting in all four of these quadrants. Let's take a look at how. Kroger is driving collaboration between humans and machines. Kroger, a US-based supermarket group, built an automated grocery warehouse in partnership with Ocado. More than 800 robots zip around the warehouse, picking and packing an entire household order in 5 to 10 minutes. But employees have a role to play here as well. Once the bots prepare the order is dropped down to an associate who gets it ready for shipping. To see how humans are being hyper-augmented by technology, let's look to DPD. DPD is a global parcel delivery organization. And in their German operations, they've partnered with German Bionic to create an exoskeleton called Cray-X. Cray-X is a wearable tool that helps employees to actively lift heavy objects and prevents injuries. They've essentially made a supersuit. Employees can work safely and feel like Iron Man. For an example of technology freeing up employees for value-added work, let's look at the utilities industry and National Grid. In partnership with Boston Dynamics and IBM, National Grid is using mobile robots, called Spot, to gather massive amounts of equipment data more reliably. This digital sidekick provides information back to human operators for improved asset management decisions. Over time, they plan to use Spot to generate automated work orders and to send an alert to initiate corrective actions. And finally, comprehensive process automation. Let's look at JD.com, a major online retailer in China. JD.com's explainable and intelligent forecasting system has enabled them to create daily sales forecasts for tens of millions of SKUs. Using self-learning, deep learning, and explainable AI, the demand forecasting process has become significantly more accurate. You're looking at the Jarvis of forecasting, guiding employees to better decision-making. It's improved forecast accuracy by 6%, increased supplier replenishment automation by 20%, and it's reduced warehousing costs by more than $20 million annually. So as we've seen, there are huge opportunities for technology and humans to work more effectively together, rather than in replacement of one another. But if employees aren't willing to adopt the technologies we deploy, then we have an entirely new problem to solve. And it seems that this problem might already be upon us. Pre-pandemic, 74% of employees were willing to support organizational change. But today, that number's been cut in half. Change fatigue has set in. Most employees say that changes are adding to their workload, making them less productive. They're constantly having to change the rhythm of their work. And in companies where changes are falling short, well over half of employees feel that they aren't supported enough through change. Getting the most from digital tools requires us to invest in designing and supporting change. For an example of a company making these investments, let's hear from Sasha Koff, SVP of Digital Supply Chain at Dell.
At Dell, our purpose is to create technologies that drive human progress. Our digital supply chain transformation ambition is grounded in this purpose. By utilizing data analytics and automation, we're turning pain points into gain points for our global team members as they continue to improve customer experience, manage costs, and optimize supply chain operations. At Dell, we're well on our way to fully achieve our autonomous digital supply chain ambition by keeping humans at the core of our efforts. First, we have and will continue to invest in scaling digital literacy across our global supply chain team, utilizing next-generation learning curricula and persona-driven approaches. This allows us to ensure trainings are assigned and support growth, regardless of one's skill competency. Second, we use technologies to help us understand teamwork patterns in addition to specific employee requirement gathering efforts to ensure our solutions truly meet our employees' needs. And we are continuously looking for ways to eliminate options to work outside of our standard tools. Last, but certainly not least, we're driving adoption of our digital solutions by establishing adoption contracts with our user communities. These contracts outline user acceptance metrics to ensure tools developed are intuitive to use while improving business performance across our plan, source, make, and deliver functions. The future of supply chain operations promises to be an exciting and dynamic landscape, and digital advancement will allow new ways of working through greater hindsight, insight, and foresight capabilities. At Dell, we strongly believe that our talent and technology must evolve together to remain competitive. Our digital efforts are not intended to replace humans, but rather to multiply human potential. Our digital transformation efforts will continue to harness the collective potential of people, communities, technology, with the intention of continuing to achieve new levels of employee and customer satisfaction.
Building employee confidence in technology, getting them to trust it, getting them to use it, turning pain points into gain points. This requires a better support structure. Sasha talked about the adoption contracts they put in place at Dell. These allow employees to give feedback on the intuitive nature of the technology. And it's a great example of reciprocal learning. Reciprocal learning is humans having the opportunity to make sense of technology, and technology having the opportunity to adapt to human input. For example, when crowdsourcing new ideas, humans and machines can be equal contributors. Humans can share ideas based on their domain knowledge, and machines can harness this human insight and become an active member of the crowd, providing analytics-generated insights. Process mining also provides us with another great opportunity. Machines can help identify deviations from standard process, and human judgment can teach the technology what is good and bad deviation. Good deviations happen when an employee finds a low-effort, low-risk workaround. Bad deviations are those that break compliance requirements. Even skill building can use reciprocal learning. Investments in data literacy ensure employees speak data and analytics. This is something Dell is investing in. Humans augment machines with better data inputs and clearer business requirements. And machines build analytical models that provide the best decision path. Fully unlocking technological potential starts with the reflection of where we can play to the strengths of our people. But technology change is hard. So design for reciprocal learning, where employees can experiment with technology and technology can learn from human input. This allows us to rewrite the script from a dystopian horror story to a superhero story, where humans and technologies each play their part. Now, I started today with my dad's story, a man who dedicated his working life to supply chain. But his roots are actually in engineering. Literal family roots. My great-grandfather was an engineer. My grandfather was an engineer. Even my dad's cousins were engineers. So with three generations of engineers behind me, I knew exactly what was expected of me. So I studied to become a veterinarian. But by a turn of fate, or maybe it was the power of those dinner table conversations, I ended up in a career in supply chain. And like all of you, I want to leave a powerful legacy. And when I think about that legacy, when we think about that legacy, it should be one of lighting up brilliant careers, enabling supply chain to be a mission-critical engine for growth, ensuring a sustainable future for all. But to earn that legacy, we must create a new peak of productivity. We must unlock our collective potential. We can unlock individual potential by designing roles that make the full use of our employees' varied skills, and by displaying the human leadership skills of authenticity, empathy, and adaptivity. And we can unlock community potential by mobilizing people beyond the hierarchy and guaranteeing their decision quality with the three C's. And we can use technology to its fullest potential by considering the relative strengths of humans and technology, and by embracing reciprocal learning. By taking action today, collectively, we can reach new peaks of productivity. We can unlock our full potential. We can build a supply chain legacy that makes us proud. Thank you.
We hope you enjoyed the session. If your next session is in this room, please remain seated. Otherwise, please make your way to your next location. We hope you enjoyed the session. If your next session is in this room, please remain seated. Otherwise, please make your way to your next location. Gotta be strong. Something not right, but we know that we're better together. You can say what they want, I'll be there for you. Gotta keep our head up. Gotta be strong. Something not right, but we know that we're better together. You can say what they want, I'll be there for you. I love you when you're standing proud. Still love you.